The United States has long been known for its countless national parks and forests. These parks are made up of various landscapes and attract visitors from around the world every year. Depending on its location, these sites tend to be quite large and sometimes extremely remote. The state of Idaho is home to a few of these sprawling forests. Idaho County stretches more than 8,500 square miles. And more than 80% of that area is made up of dense landscapes with steep mountain ranges. One forest that includes all those characteristics is Idaho's Nez Perce National Forest. On October 5th, 2018, Terrence Shamel Woods Jr. ventured to Nez Perce as part of a 12-person film crew. The 26-year-old Maryland native was a production assistant on set of the Discovery Channel series Gold Rush. Premiering in 2010, Gold Rush documents the mining endeavors of family-operated mining companies. This was one of many film crews Terrence had been a part of. After earning his journalism degree at the University of Maryland, Terrence ventured to London, where he would work for 5 years before returning to the United States in 2018. It was in London where he found work on shows like UK's The Voice. He'd also begin work with London-based production company, Raw TV, the same company that would hire him for the filming of Gold Rush. For Terrence, October 5th was just another work day. His work had taken him all over the world by this point. In fact, it wasn't even his first time in the Idaho wilderness. He'd actually visited the area for film projects in the past. Being that this was a documentary type of project, filming for Gold Rush would last the entire day. So it was in the early evening that filming concluded. As the crew packed up, Terrence was spotted mingling with some of the town's locals that had been on set. He told them that he needed to use the bathroom and excused himself. Moments later, Simon G, an associate producer on set, says that he saw Terrence approach the edge of a cliffside, and it appeared that he was looking down at something. Simon says that he then saw Terrence drop his radio to the ground, which he thought was strange, but he didn't think much of it. Simon looked away for a moment, but when he looked back, he could no longer see Terrence. Simon thought Terrence must have slipped and fallen from the cliffside, so he ran over to investigate. He said that he could see Terrence running down the cliffside at a rapid rate of speed. Assuming something must be wrong, he told some of the crew workers to hop in the crew's van and head down the main road. That road intersected with the path Terrence was running, so they hoped to catch him towards the bottom of the cliff. Simon said that he then ran down the cliffside in pursuit of Terrence. He claimed that he'd never seen someone run as fast as Terrence did that day. Due to the rough terrain, Simon says he was unable to keep up with Terrence, and he soon saw him disappear into the woods. Once the crew's van reached the bottom of the cliff, they too were unable to see Terrence. It was around 6:41 p.m. that same evening that Terrence's disappearance was reported to the Idaho County Sheriff's Office. Since it was already late in the day, police could not set a search in motion immediately. So it wasn't until the following day that the search for Terrence officially began. The search team was massive. There were scent-sniffing dogs brought out, police searching by horseback, and even helicopters equipped with heat-seeking cameras to comb the forest. They were looking for any signs of Terrence they could find. Maybe he was hurt and was unable to call for help. Or perhaps he'd gotten lost and was unable to find his way back to the film site. Searchers did their best to leave no stone unturned. The search party certainly had their work cut out for them, though. The rugged landscape created many obstacles that made it difficult to navigate. To add to this, rainstorms had moved into the area a few days into the search. Unfortunately, this could have served to wash away helpful evidence or clues. The team scoured the area meticulously, but after 6 days, there was no trace of Terrence, and the search was called off. Police felt that Terrence should have turned up if he was still in the forest. They began to suspect that he slipped away by choice, that maybe he wanted to disappear and use this as an opportunity to do so. It was still tough to determine how exactly Terrence got away so quick. After all, he would have had to navigate that same rough area in order to reach any main roads. No one could really make sense of the situation, but one thing was clear. Terrence Woods Jr. was still missing. Back in Maryland, Terrence's family had been notified of the situation. In the week following the disappearance, Raw TV flew his mother and father to Idaho in order to speak with the police. Simon G., who initially pursued Terrence down to Cliffside, was one of two Raw TV employees present during this meeting. According to Valerie and Terrence Woods Sr., Simon expressed some disappointment in their son's work performance. He went on to say that he'd had high expectations of Terrence, but felt let down. According to Simon, Terrence seemed distracted while working on the set. Valerie and Terrence Sr. were surprised at these comments. They'd spoken with people who worked with their son in the past and heard nothing but good things. Furthermore, they had trouble believing the film crew's account of what occurred that day. They'd never known Terrence to act erratic or out of character in the ways being described. And they couldn't picture their son just deciding to run down a cliffside at random. Things just weren't making sense. Family and friends said that Terrence acted completely normal in the days leading to his disappearance. They couldn't recall any signs that he might be sad or upset about anything. He'd been excited about working on the Gold Rush series and seemed to be looking forward to the first day of shooting. Terrence had even posted a photo of the Nez Perce scenery to his Instagram that morning, actions that don't seem to coincide with a depressed mindset. However, there was one thing that Terrence Sr. recalled. In the early morning hours of October 5th, he received a text from his son. In the text, Terrence told his father that he'd be returning home to Maryland on October 10th, so this would shorten his trip significantly. Terrence Sr. wondered why his son would be coming home so early. He asked what was going on, but never got a response. It'd be later on that day that Terrence disappeared. According to Raw TV, Terrence had also informed them that he'd be departing early. He said that he was going home to tend to his mother. Terrence explained that he was concerned for his mother's health and felt it was best to be with her. His mother did have a previous medical condition that may have required surgery. However, she recovered and says that she told Terrence everything was fine and the surgery would not be needed. It's also rumored that Terrence may have had trouble meshing with the Gold Rush production crew. Some of the workers described his behavior that day as odd and withdrawn. In one police report, it was alleged that he was dealing with some type of emotional stress and had suffered a mental breakdown. Those closest to Terrence highly doubt this, as he'd never dealt with any mental troubles in the past. To them, the entire scenario seems bizarre. When last spoken to, Terrence was in good spirits and making future plans with loved ones. If he did intend to run off, it's likely they'd have seen some type of signs. With the third anniversary of Terrence's disappearance approaching, his family still prays that one day their loved one will return home, or at the least, some answers will surface as to what happened to him. It's important to note, though, this wasn't the only disappearance that took place in the Idaho wilderness that week. About 56 miles north of Nez Perce Forest lies Big Fog Mountain. It was here that 76-year-old Connie Johnston also went missing. Connie had been working as a cook at a camp in the area. This location was also remote with no main roads. In fact, it was only reachable by horse or by foot. Hunters at the camp last saw Connie on October 2, 2018. They departed the camp with intentions to return the very next day. After leaving, they'd had radio contact with Connie, but due to a weak signal, couldn't understand what she was saying. When they did arrive back, they say that Connie, along with her dog Ace, were nowhere to be found. What's most interesting about Connie Johnson's case is that she was an experienced outdoors person. She had previously worked as a wilderness ranger and oftentimes led tours of the area. If anyone was able to navigate the terrain and stay safe, it'd be Connie. Once again, a large search party was summoned, and they did their best to find Connie. But just like Terrence Woods' case, no trace of her was found. Her search was officially called off on October 16, 2018. About 3 weeks after this, Connie's dog Ace was found 15 miles from the campsite. Investigators hoped Ace might be able to lead them to Connie, so he was taken out into the forest for the attempt. Still, no signs of her. As both of these strange mysteries continue to age, it's urged that if you have any information or believe you've seen Terrence Woods or Connie Johnson, that you contact the appropriate authorities.